So for the webinar for today, it's going to be presented by Professor Sebastien, Marcel, and the title is Phrase Presentation Attack Detection. So a topic I assume many of you are familiar with, and it's really timely, really, really important for biometrics and for the security of biometrics. I'm sure all of you know Professor Marcel, but just as a short intro, I would like to say a few words from his bio. So Sebastien Marcel is a professor at the University de Lausanne at the School of Criminal Justice and a lecturer at the École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne, where he's teaching biometrics and the fundamentals in statistical pattern recognition. He serves on the program committee of several scientific journals and international conferences in pattern recognition and computer vision. He's a senior researcher at the IDIAP Research Institute in Switzerland and heads the biometric security and privacy group and conducts research on face recognition, speaker recognition, vein recognition, and attack detection, also template protection. He's the director of the Swiss Center for Biometric Research and Testing and an associate editor for the IEEE Transactions on Biometrics and Identity Science, and a lot of other journals. He also served as an associate editor. Maybe also worth pointing out, he is the lead editor for the Springer Handbook on Biometrics and Anti-Spoofing for editions 1, 2, and 3. So I would like to give the stage now to Sebastien. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. So good morning, good afternoon, or good evening to everyone, wherever you are. So thank you for this opportunity to give this presentation today. So we're going to be together for a bit more than an hour. I will give a presentation, so I don't know really how long it's going to take, but in case I speak too much, you can stop me anytime anyway. And I will be delighted to answer any of your questions. So it's going to be an overview talk on the field. Of course, I'm not able to cover the work from everyone in the field, but it has been very, very active over the last 10 years, I would say. And so there are many work from many teams, great groups in worldwide, and I guess that many of the people who are attending today actually have contributed to this field. So the title of this presentation is Face Presentation Attack Detection. So I'm going to talk today. And yes, as Vitos mentioned, I'm working for the IDIAP Research Institute, which is the building you can see here in the Swiss mountains, or throughout the window that you don't see because of my virtual background. But so I'm going to talk to you about this topic right now. So this is going to be the outline of the presentation. I'm going to give a rapid introduction. I'm going to spend, since we have some time, I'm going to spend some time into the looking at pop culture and the example of spoofing or presentation attacks in movies. I'm going to show a couple of examples I've managed to collect over the years. Then we'll move back to reality, so examples of presentation attacks in reality. Then we'll be looking at different types of how to perform attacks, mostly presentation attack instruments. A quick introduction about how to detect those attacks, so presentation attack detection, with a focus on face presentation attack detection. And I will just give some examples of ways to do it, either in the using the visual spectra, so this is what is mentioned here as VIS, or in using multispectral information. And I will conclude. So first, I would like to show this diagram, which is a diagram which is inspired, actually more than inspired. It comes from this paper from Nalini Rata in 2001, where we have the big picture of what is a biometric system. And in this paper, the biometric system has been analyzed and it has been highlighted over the last years that you can attack a biometric system in many ways, in many places. So you can see all the attack points here with different number and different color. In this presentation, we are mostly interested by one specific attack, which is attack number one, which is actually a direct attack, which has been coined in literature for many years and still a little bit today as spoofing, but now which should be referred, because the term has been standardized, as a presentation attack. So we are going to look in this talk today simply and solely on attacks to biometric system that can be performed at the sensor level. I'm going to explain what it means. And therefore, we'll also consider how to detect those attacks. It will be the presentation attack detection part. So we need to put a number of definitions first. So what is a presentation attack? So the definition that is used nowadays for what is a presentation attack, this is an attempt to fool a biometric system by presenting a fake biometric data to the sensor with two goals. Either you want to make a replica of someone who is enrolled in the system, and the goal is to impersonate the user, so when you want to take the identity of someone, basically. Or you want to use generic biometric features that you replicate in order to avoid to be recognized. And you will see an example of that today. So there are two cases. Either you want to impersonate or you want to obfuscate your own identity. So presentation attack is a global term that covers those two cases. So in the literature, you can still use the old term that is referred to as spoofing attacks. And you can use the term spoof refers to the fake biometric data that is used. But please note that more and more we are using this standardized term of presentation attack. Then by extension, once we have defined what is a presentation attack, we should define what is presentation attack detection, or PAD for short. So PAD is the determination of a presentation attack. So either what is presented, the presented biometric data is or not a fake, a spoof, or a presentation attack. Similarly, you will refine in the literature the use of anti-spoofing, but now more and more we're moving to this term of PAD. Two other terms I like to introduce as for definitions is the term presentation attack instrument, or PAI for short. This refers to the biometric characteristic or the object that is used to perform, to launch the presentation attack. For example, you can use a face mask in order to perform a presentation attack. So the face mask is going to be the presentation attack instrument. You could make a fake fingerprint, a gummy fingerprint, for instance. To present the fake fingerprint, in which case the gummy fingerprint will be the presentation attack instrument, but you can use also other things which are not objects that have been created. For instance, you can use the dead body parts. We have seen some work from people in US and Poland who are using iris from cadaver. This is something that could be considered as per definition of a presentation attack instrument. Then the last term I'd like to introduce is the term bona fide presentation. So bona fide presentation is a presentation which is basically normal. So this with the intention to be recognized. So the normal user is going to present his biometric. And if it is not a presentation attack detection, it is a bona fide presentation. So then we have two things. We have a bona fide presentation, which is normal use of the system and biometric data you get from it. And you can get a presentation attack. So you have two scenarios. And those standards are not, those definitions sorry, are not mine, but they come from the standards. So the ISO standards, you can find them in the document for which I provide the reference. So why this topic is something important? So this is actually, it was and is still a major threat for biometric systems which are operational, which are this move to operation, because this form of attack is actually external to the sensor. So you don't need to be advanced an engineer or a skilled hacker in order to launch an attack. You don't need to have a deep knowledge into the internal workings of a biometric system in order to launch an attack, right? This is something you can do easily, almost that kids can do. Actually, I'll show you an example. So almost everyone can launch a presentation attack. So because it is simple to do, that's present an important threat, a major threat to biometric system, face recognition systems, and others. So which means that detection means for those attacks are required. So we're going to look together a couple of examples from movies and realities, and we'll see that, of course, there is a difference between realities and fiction. So let's look at a couple of examples in movies. So the first one of the first one I found, I know there is another one earlier in a James Bond movie with fingerprints, but here I prefer to start with this one. So in the you have this this original series called MacGyver, and in this episode you have the character that wanted to bypass a handprint scanner of a military base, and what he did, he used his knife, of course Swiss Army knife, to scratch some plaster dust out of the wall, right? And then with that, he sprinkled the plaster over the sensor in order to reveal the palm prints, and then pressed with his jacket on the scanner, and then like this, he bypassed recognition. Of course, that's a movie, right? And it's unlikely to work in practice.
You are clear all the way up.
So this is another example. I'm going to let you watch and listen to it, and then we will comment. Right, so this was interesting. So the first thing you can notice, that is a case of a presentation attack, which is made with a replay device, so against a voice biometric system, so voice recognition system. And here, what you can observe is the way that the presentation attack is done, and probably the way that the original data, the original audio of the person that you are trying to attack. So there is a person which should be recognized by the system, who is expected for which we can hear the voice on the microphone here on the replay device, and then that original voice has been obtained. In the movie, they explain how to do it. They obtain different recordings of voice of different words of that person, and they concatenated it in order to do the playback here on the replay device. So here, what we can understand from this also, that we have a specific voice recognition system. Actually, we have a text-dependent speaker recognition systems, which means that actually there is a text which is expected. As you can see, there is a text which is prompted here. So the person should say, hi, my name is the name of the person, my voice is my password, verify me. So you need to say all this in order to be recognized. So here the difficulty lies in the fact of being able to replicate the voice of a specific person, right? Saying exactly that those words in this context. In this particular case, it was obtained by stealing recordings of a person and concatenating voices, so words. Nowadays, there are more advanced techniques in speech synthesis and voice conversion can be used in order to produce similar utterances that can be playback. So this is actually quite a realistic attack. Another example from Demolition Man, which is a US movie, where a prisoner tried to escape prison by stealing, by bypassing an iris recognition system, right? By stealing removing the eyeball of someone in the prison in order to escape from jail. So just let's say an ugly example, but sometimes you can see that. I won't say reality equal to fiction, but we have seen a recent work on iris recognition with dead eyes. So, which means that this is something that is might be a threat that can be explored. DNA. So in Gattaca, you can find examples of someone that is using the DNA, actually blood samples or cells from someone else in order to hide his identity and then to be recognized as someone else. I'm not going to enter into the details because we need to speed up. We have a long presentation. But here, this movie, we have a very interesting example of someone using using artifacts in order so fake fingertips, for instance, where he can inject blood from someone else in order to bypass DNA sampling. Iris recognition. So in this movie, from Minority Report, the character went surgery to replace, to do eye swapping, so eyeball swapping. Basically, he got the eyeballs from someone else, in which case the iris of someone else, in order not to be recognized. So this is, in which case, a case of obfuscation. This is an interesting case as well. So here there will be a question at the end, so be attentive to what is going to be displayed on the scanner.
Dropped his contact lens. Perhaps you'd like to help us. Found it! I found it!
Have a good day.
Right. So a couple of interesting things here and two things I'd like to mention. So first is that from when you see how the attack is performed, this is a contact lens which is used, and you have this strange pattern on the which is displayed on the contact lens, which makes us think that is probably an attack to an iris recognition system, right? Although we can discuss about the whether the attack is pertinent in reality, but something you may have observed in the scanner is that it was displaying ready for retinal scan and not ready for iris scan. So you can see that there is a mistake. Actually, there is an error in this movie, that there is a confusion between what is an iris scan and what is a retinal scan. Just for the comment. Okay, so that's enough for the movies. We're going to review a couple of examples from the reality. So I'm going to start with a couple of cases in forensics. We have a number of cases of robbery that have been done mostly in the US actually, where we have people that manage to, they are buying silicon masks on the internet, right? And they are wearing those masks in order to hide their identity, and then to rob banks. And like this, they are not going to be spotted. Their real identity is not spotted on camera. So we had a case in 2010. We had another case in 2011. Actually, that guy managed to rob 11 banks in the US. We have another case in 2012, so you can see that actually this is quite this was quite popular at some point to use fake masks. More recently, in 2019, someone tried to do exactly the same in Brazil, so to rob banks with face masks. You have seen that all in those cases, all the people have been arrested finally, and this is how we knew they were using face masks. This one is a famous case, an immigration case, where you had this young person that managed to board a plane in Hong Kong to travel to Vancouver, I think, to Canada. And then he was wearing actually this mask of a whole man when he boarded the plane until he got arrested. Another case of jailbreak this time, so where in Brazil, where a drug trafficker was serving a prison sentence, he was in jail. So he tried to escape. So he tried, because it didn't work. He tried to escape jail disguised as his young daughter, because he had the visit for his daughter, and she took with her a mask and some disguise. And then he tried to swap his identity and to leave wearing these masks. Obviously, it didn't work. Another case I would like to be more serious one I like to show is this smartphone unlock feature that was released on Android in 2011. So I'm going to show a video.
Hello everybody, this is soyochincha.com, and we're still at the regional launch of the Samsung Galaxy Note and the first appearance of the Galaxy Nexus. Alright, so previously I showed you the face unlock feature on the Galaxy Nexus, and we got a question from Twitter asking, hey, does the Galaxy Nexus recognize printed faces, face unlock, does it work with printed faces? So hey, that's something curious and we want to try it out. So I have the Galaxy Note with me, and I've taken my picture, right? And I've already programmed the Nexus to recognize my picture. So let's see what happens. Okay. Unlocked.
So you can see that, so it was not so curious actually, because it was 2011. And when you know, actually this form of vulnerability was already exposed several years ago, so it was not really a surprise. But then what is interesting is that a couple of months later, Android released a liveness check feature in order to detect the eye blink, in order to avoid this form of attacks. Another example of that I would like to mention, which is the case of the iPhone 10. So in 2017, the iPhone 10 was launched with Face ID, which is now equipping all iPhones since then. So it was also reported that the iPhone 10, the Face ID, could be spoofed by some researchers in Vietnam. So there have been two press releases and a couple of, at least one videos. But actually, we haven't found many cases of other cases of or attempts or successful attempts to spoof the iPhone 10. This one is an animation, a video without audio. So I was telling you that it was pretty easy to create an attack, that anyone can do it. This is just an illustration. In China, when you have lockers that can be unlocked with face recognition, so you can find you can see the students, you know, the school children that manage to use a printed photo in order to unlock a locker. So other examples in the fingerprints were this case of Brazilian doctors that were and other employees in the hospital that were using fake fingerprints to clock in, right? So in order to get their pay without going to work, someone else was clocking on their behalf, right, with their fake fingerprints. So that it was an interesting case, 2013. 2013 also still fingerprints, face so Touch ID by Apple, that actually was demonstrating it can be faked in 28 hours after it was released, and the recipe is available on the internet. Finger vein also has been demonstrated it can be spoofed to some extent with paper, actually showing that you can unroll a piece of paper containing the vein information. Also, you can find details on the internet. Iris on mobile phones were demonstrated that can be spoofed. You can find the video here. I have it here, but maybe in order to save time, I'm going to pass on this one. Maybe you're right. But here, it's again the same group that managed to demonstrate how to spoof the fingerprints, the Touch ID on the app on the iPhone. So the Chaos Computer Club in Germany, that have shown that they can also use a recipe on how to attack the iris recognition on the Samsung Galaxy S8 with a printed photograph and a contact lens. So the video is available, but I'm going to skip it for the moment. Right. So I presented an introduction, some a couple of examples from movies and realities, and you can see already there's kind of a gap between the two. So now let's go back to science and with definitions, experiments that have been done, what exists in the literature. So I'm going to present now a couple of presentation attack instruments. So you remember that presentation attack instrument is a biometric characteristic of an object which is used to launch an attack, right? I'm going to focus mainly on face presentation attack instruments since this is mostly our field of expertise in the group. So we can broadly group the presentation attack instruments in three categories. You can put on one side the attacks which are performed or conducted with a photograph or recording. So which means that the person performing the attack, the attacker, will acquire a source photograph of or video of the target and is going to replay it to the biometric system. So when I say replay, display it to biometric system. We could also create a synthetic biometric characteristic. So the attacker will generate a synthetic model of the target and is going to present it to the recognition system. Again, by doing a presentation attack. We can also consider self-modification. So here in the self-modification is that that the attacker will alter physically or digitally the biometric data in order to mimic the target or to avoid to be recognized. So we're going to show some examples of what has been done in the literature for those three categories. First, let's start with the simplest of all attacks, which is the presentation attack instrument for face, which consists of printing a face on a piece of paper. This is actually so it can be printed on paper. It can also display on the screen, as we can see later, as you have seen with the demo with mobile phones that was done during a live show a couple of minutes ago. So here, this work is not new. Something that was presented already, an idea that was presented in 2009 at Black Hat in Las Vegas. So here the idea, the recipe is to print the image of the target on paper and present that face image to the face recognition system. At that time, the researchers that presented that work demonstrated that they can bypass three commercial face recognition system that were embedded on laptops. The same thing can be done with by doing a digital display. So you can use a screen, either a small screen or a large screen, to display picture or display a video, right, that you have recorded. And so you have the camera out of the attack system that is going to see the image on that screen. So for instance, in this setup, you can observe here, you can see first a laptop here. This laptop is just used to display an image or a video that is displayed on the larger monitor here. And then you have the camera of this iPhone, the mobile system. So the camera, which is running the face recognition system, which is capturing the face, which is displayed on the screen. So this is a setup. And you can find one of the first databases that was mimicking this setup, which is the Replay Mobile database, which is available for research if you want to look at this setup. So here we have examples of images which are seen from the camera, which is running the face recognition system. And here I could give you as a quiz the task to tell me which one you think is a bona fide or presentation attack, according to the definitions I gave at the beginning. So if you look at the pictures here and you are asked to answer that question, I'm just going to give you a couple of seconds so you can look at it. Could you figure out which image is a bona fide? So this is a real person in front of the camera, or which image is a presentation attack? So this is something which is presented in front of the camera. Just giving you a couple of seconds to look at this. Right, so you may think, by looking at it, you may say, okay, these ones look weird. So actually you can observe stripes here. So this one may be not very good quality. I think there are presentation attacks. And maybe you can say that this one also is a presentation attack because it's a bit blurry. Actually, all of them are presentation attacks. There are two differences. So the difference is where the source comes from, right? And how the attack is presented. So the first row here, you have the source image of the attack, which has been obtained on a white uniform background. So we took a picture of that person with a uniform background. The second row here is that that person has been captured, the source image of that person has been captured with a more complex background. That's it. This is the only difference between the two rows. Now, the difference with the different columns is the type of a presentation attack instrument that was used. So here we used paper. This was paper that was presented to the camera. Here it was a mobile phone that was used. So the image was displayed on a mobile phone and presented to the camera. And here we use a larger screen like a tablet or a monitor in front of the camera. And you can guess this by analyzing, looking more closely at the images. And so I don't know on your screen, you can see clearly, but you have when you have access to the original image, you can see it. You can see printing artifacts. You can see all those stripes on those images, which are the printed artifacts because we use them. With a printer which has those printing artifacts. Here you can see the image a bit more blurry. This is because here this is out of focus. Because when you use a mobile phone, and if you don't want to see the border of the phone with your hands holding the phone, you have to come very, very close to the camera, right? So that the screens fits all the field of view of the camera. So therefore you're out of focus and you get something which is a bit blurry. And then if you're right on focus, right at distance from the camera with a large screen, for instance, you are going to have a very good quality attack. So all of these are fakes. Right, let's move to another example of a biometric characteristic presentation attack instrument, which would be the synthetic case. So here the idea is to make a face mask made of paper. So here, you can use a number of services that exist or existed in the particular case because the service that's myface.com don't exist anymore, unfortunately. But we have the data to make those masks if you're interested. So here you can use, for instance, you can use a couple of pictures to make 3D models. And with these 3D models, it is possible, for instance, to make paper versions. We can cut, fold, and glue to make your 3D mask made of paper. The advantage is quite cheap. But it's not very effective from the point of view of impersonation. We made a couple of experiments with that, and it's very difficult to get a realistic face, which is sufficiently realistic to bypass face recognition. So this is not effective to impersonation, but it can be quite effective, obviously, to do obfuscation, to hide your own identity. So another example would be also to make a 3D mask, but this one a hard face mask made of resin. So again, there used to be this service that my face, but now you can find similar services on the internet, 3D printing companies, even where you can get masks of the like. So you still need to acquire a couple of 2D images in order to provide the service, or to make a 3D model out of it, or to scan a 3D scan, or to make a 3D scan, for instance, which is quite easy nowadays. Then when you get the mask, you can present that mask to the reconstruction system. At that stage, we have demonstrated that this type of mask were effective to spoof, to bypass 2D face recognition systems, but they won't be effective to bypass 3D face recognition systems because this is actually not the exact 3D shape of a person. These masks are a bit more expensive than the paper masks. So about $300, that's still the case for almost all the 3D printing services nowadays. So we can have very good colors which are rendered, but since this is rigid, right, there is no natural movement that can be expressed. Also, this mask is full, completely plain, so there is no holes for the eyes or anything like this. What you can do, you can make a variant of those masks. So you can make variants with holes for the eyes. So if you wear them, you can do eye blinking, which means that if you have eye blinking for PAD, then it's obsolete. And you will need to find another way to do the presentation attack detection. You can make masks which are realistic in 2D, but not realistic in 3D. You can make masks which are realistic, which are actually really the 3D shape, like the example you have here. But sometimes these masks will have the difficulty to render the color correctly. Nowadays, you can move also to hyper-realistic masks. So there are examples of hyper-realistic masks we have here at IDIAP. So they are made in Japan. They are very expensive because they use a very specific process to manufacture those masks. These are basically plastic made. So the color rendering is very good. The 3D shape is accurate. So those masks are very interesting and intriguing. So we're still studying those masks. There are a couple of papers from researchers in Hong Kong, if I remember correctly. So PC and Nguyen that have published a couple of work and have published a couple of papers on some of these masks. Let's move to silicon masks. As you have seen, silicon masks were quite popular for bank robbers. So this is also why we started to investigate those silicon masks and their effectiveness. So first thing you can do is consider, like the bank robbers, as a generic silicon masks for impersonation. For obfuscation, not impersonation. So basically, you don't know who is the identity of this mask, but you can use this mask to see what are the properties of those. The advantage that those silicon masks are quite accessible, I would say about $800. So you can get quite a number of different types of those masks on the internet. You can find some of these on this website here. All right, wait a second. Yes. Now, the interesting bit is, can you manufacture silicon masks which are customed to a specific identity? So for instance, can I make my silicon mask and bypass face recognition? So something we explored also a couple of years ago. So we tried with several companies, and we found a company and a manufacturing process to make custom masks for specific persons without having to mold the face of the person, because typically this is the way you should do it. So here we use a rough 3D scan, some frontal measurements, couple of high quality pictures, and we asked actually an artist, someone who is used to make those masks, to do it. So he made first a mold, he made a mold in clay, so he can pour silicone inside, and then after he had got the silicone mask, he painted it. So you get at the end of the day this type of final masks that you can actually, they are auto adhesive. You can take them, you can wear them, you can leave them on the support in order to do presentation attack. These masks are quite expensive because it's actually done manually by an expert. So it's very difficult to find skilled people to do it. That explains also the cost. But that's a very intriguing and very interesting mask to be explored. We have the chance to have about 15 different masks of different 15 different persons for which we have the original data as well. So we can make experiments in terms of vulnerability, which we did in the past. So either to assess whether those masks present a threat, and also to study if we can detect those masks, obviously. Another presentation attack instrument I'd like to mention is, as a case of self-modification, is makeup. So makeup is an intriguing and probably very challenging attack as well, because here, when you have a makeup, the problem is that you have a real person wearing makeup to change his appearance. So here you have an example of an artist on the internet that is using makeup to change his appearance to look like characters of a famous web series movie. And here what is impressive is that it's just makeup. There is no prosthetics which are used. It's only makeup. It's sufficient to change your appearance to impersonate someone or to obfuscate even your identity. So makeup also can be used, something we have done. So it was very difficult to use makeup with makeup artists to take any identity. For instance, it's very difficult for me to transform myself in Tom Cruise, let's say. But it's very easy to use makeup to do obfuscation. And we did something similar where we use makeup to age someone. And with this, we have been able to conduct studies. So this is the same person on the same day, apply different level of makeup iteratively, no prosthetics, really just makeup. And then with that, you can change sufficiently the appearance to age someone. And then we have observed that actually at some point, face recognition is going to fail. So at some point, when you reach a degree of makeup which is too important, then you are not able to match anymore those two faces. Another example of self-modification is morphing. Morphing is something which becomes more and more popular also these days as a research problem. This work originates from the original work from people from researchers from Bologna University in Italy. In 2014, where they published this paper called the Magic Passport that I encourage you to read, where they have demonstrated that a new form of attack that you can take two look-alike and those two different identities, make a morph out of it. And then with this morph, they observe that if you take two other images of the attacker and the target, each of those two images of those two different persons can be matched against the morph. So as you can imagine, this is really a potential problem for identity documents for all places where you bring yourself a picture and you can get a genuine identity document that contains a morph, which would allow two persons to travel with the same identity document. This is an example for me. This is an example, a case of presentation attack, which is performed at enrollment stage. So basically here, the idea is to alter the data, which is used for as a reference. So when you compare to it at prop time. Another example of self-modification are the deepfakes technologies. With deepfake technologies, you can mostly do face swaps. So this is what is the most relevant in biometrics. So you want to change the identity of someone. So you have a video of an original video of a person, and you want to generate to have the same video, possibly the person saying exactly the same thing, but you just insert the face of someone else onto the body of someone else, and you have that person to say exactly or do exactly the same thing, but looking differently. So this is something that is also quite of a threat. Even the same technologies can be used to make better morphs, or to make morphs with less artifacts, at least. So these technologies also should be considered as a way to make a presentation attack. Right. So I think I'm done with the inventory of the presentation attack instruments for face. And now I'm going to move to the second part of the presentation, the presentation which is on PAD. So first, just a quick recap. When we do biometric recognition, let's say face recognition, we have a biometric system that receives a prop image that is compared to reference, and its goal is to accept or reject. We have a binary system, a binary classifier. What happens, and then when we have this situation, we know how to measure the accuracy. We measure the false match rate and the FMR and the FNMR, right? So basically, and so you can do that with bona fide presentation attacks, which actually can be either the person who is enrolled or a zero effort impostor. And you count the number of errors there. Now, in reality, when you have exposed to presentation attack, what you don't only have bona fide, so genuine presentations and zero effort impostors, you also have informed impostors, which are the presentation attacks. So what we're interested in is to look at those presentation attacks, to inject them in the biometric system and to see how many times they are going to be overlapping, I mean, recognized as someone else, as an enrolled identity. So here we are also focusing only on the impersonation case of the presentation attack. So here we can count how many times a presentation attack is successful. If we do that, wait a second, just following my slide. Yes, if we do that, you can simply count how many times a presentation attack by exceed the recognition threshold, assuming a verification set scenario. And you can, by doing this, you can also plot the score distribution. So you could have here the score distribution in blue of the genuines, in red, the zero for the posters, and the presentation attacks, the spoofs, as we used to say, which will be the third distribution. And then if you have your threshold that separates the genuine and the zero for the impostors, then you also can count how many of those presentation attacks exceed. That's going to give you a number, so that is called now the impostor attack presentation match rate, AAPMR, that is going to tell you whether your biometric system is vulnerable to this specific attack. In the past, a couple of years ago, we have made an evaluation of whether the most recent face recognition system based on conventional neural networks, which are claimed to be very accurate, which is true, which are very accurate, were more vulnerable. And what we have observed is that actually at that time, face recognition systems, which were very accurate, actually were also the most vulnerable to print and replay presentation attacks. And when you think about it, it actually makes complete sense, because the CNNs are trained to remove noise and keep identity information. And therefore, when you present a presentation attack, they are going to be more vulnerable, because they remove everything that is noise that can be used to detect actually it is a presentation attack, just containing the identity information. And this is why they are more vulnerable. It was an interesting observation. Now, this is only for the vulnerability assessment part. Now, what about the detection part? So this time you have bona fide and presentation attacks. And what you want to do in presentation attack detection, again, you have a binary classifier in a sense, and you want to be able to say what I see is real or fake, it's a normal presentation or presentation attack. Therefore, since this is a binary classifier, you can measure as usual two errors, but these errors have just two different names that come from the standards again, which are the attack presentation classification error rates, APCR, and bona fide presentation classification error rate, BPCR. So the two errors that we want to minimize when you have a binary classifier. So here it's exactly the same. The only thing that's going to change is the algorithm that is used to do the PID. Overall, you have three ways to do PID. So there are three categories of methods. So either you have what I would refer to as software-based methods, which are methods where you use biometric data from the same data that come from the sensor that is used to do biometric recognition. You are going to use it in a different way to do bona fide versus presentation attack, for instance, using motion or texture. You can also use hardware-based techniques, right? Where you use an additional sensor in order to analyze and to analyze the data differently to discriminate. For instance, you can use a thermal sensor, or you can use also challenge response mechanism. So where you have the user that interacts with the system, so you can prompt speech text, for instance, and you can have a face recognition system and a speech recognition system. Or you can ask the person to do something particular, like move his or her head, something like this. So we have those three categories. Right, let me take a little bit more time to go through a couple of techniques in face and that are valid for the biometrics as well, for PAD. So to detect printed photo presentation attack instruments, so which is valid for face, iris, veins as well, where you can use paper. So here, you are going to exploit the fact that you have that the presentation attack is static, as a static nature. So therefore, you can use dynamic features. You can try to characterize the dynamics of what you observe in order to differentiate what is real, what is fake. For instance, for face, you can use blinking, motion of the head, etc. When you have a digital replay, photo or video, you can also try to characterize some specific artifacts from the replay devices when you recapture a digital display. Right? You have this work from Michigan State University where they have proposed to use to detect moiré patterns, for instance. For paper, you can also, for paper attacks, like these masks, you can also use motion patterns, but you can also texture, for instance, things such as local binary patterns, as simple as that, to detect these forms of attacks, which are very characteristics. Let's see. Then when you get masks which are made of resin, therefore which are rigid, you can also use motion. Right, also challenge response of some forms and try to see if you can do lip reading or analyze the motion of the face. Something else you can do, but you need to have an external sensor, will be to measure the heat. So you can have access to a thermal imaging. Then you can characterize the you can use thermal imaging in order to see if your object is has some heat. This works well if you have a rigid mask because they don't absorb heat, right? But it comes at the cost of an extra sensor, of course. When you have silicon masks, you can also think about using thermal imaging as well. The problem is that a silicon mask is going to heat up very quickly if you wear it. So at some point, it's going to have almost to have the same thermal signature than a real face. So thermal imaging can be used, but you have to be. It's not so as easy of the with the rigid masks.
Can you guess who this is? I bet you can.
I'm going to show that video again.
Can you guess who this is? I bet you can.
So this is an example of a video wearing one of our first silicon masks. And what you can see is that, yes, it seems to be gross because it was the first version, but actually it's quite impressive because you see all the facial movements, right, of the person who is talking behind the mask. So with silicon masks, now the trend is to combine, I would say, to combine different spectra, right? I'm going to speak a little more about it. So to combine different spectra and also to use the most advanced deep learning approaches in order to learn what are the correlations across different spectra that discriminates bona fide and presentation attacks. For makeups, that's more challenging. There are already some work on trying to use a visual spectra for makeup only, or to use a multispectral. But this, I would say this is still a challenge nowadays so this is clearly an area of research where there's more to do and plenty to do in order to characterize a makeup in a face for the use of presentation attack detection. Morphing attack is also a big topic. So how to detect that this image is a morph is getting more and more difficult because the morphs are increasing in quality. So artifacts tend to disappear. And also you can do that with style guns too. So and artifacts with style guns are also different. So this is also a challenge, and this is also an area of research. Similarly, defect detection is a big topic, I would say, not only for biometrics, but outside biometrics too. But here, how to detect there is a face swap that has been done, because those deepfakes now are increasing in quality. So this is also quite a challenge. Just to conclude, I'm just going to wrap up a little bit on visual spectra. So for face PAD, so basically what you can do with color, right, RGB images, you can use motion, you can use a texture, or you can analyze the mirror patterns. You can have the papers here as a wrap up. But if you want, but I think we are reaching now a limit in terms of what we can do with visual spectra only. So it's time to investigate at looking other domains that are bring some additional level of information. You can look at thermal imaging as well. You can find out nowadays quite cheap thermal imaging sensors. Near infrared, of course, which is quite affordable, very, very cheap. And looking at other spectra, more particularly, combining spectra is the most important and most interesting things, I would say. And we start to have databases that allow to do it. For instance, we have this data set that combine visual near depths and a cheap thermal image that you can synchronize for a number of subjects. We have also, there is a more advanced version of the dataset that exists where you can find high quality visual spectra, high quality stereo, near infrared in four different wavelengths, depths, high quality thermal, shortwave infrared in six different wavelengths. This database is available for research, it's been published, and it is one of the largest database in terms of diversity of presentation attacks. So it has bona fide and presentation attacks for everything I presented. So in these presentations, right? All the type of attacks. So from prints to makeup and silicon masks. With this, you can analyze what you can do with near infrared, looking at different spectra. You can also use thermal imaging, right? To only or in combination. You can also look at using shortwave infrared, which have some interesting properties. Shortwave infrared, for instance, allows wavelengths where you can find a good separation between skin and other objects, because this is near to the water absorption, and therefore skin contains a lot of water. This is where you can be optimal. Right, and just to finish on a couple of works that have been using these recent data sets that I've, and also approaches using multi-channel, multi-domains, and CNNs. So you can have a look. This work is, I would say that the work in presentation attack detection is not solved yet, right? Because the quality of the attacks are improving. And one of the main issues is the generalization, I would say, and mostly the generalization to unseen attacks. So I encourage many of you to focus on, to work on this topic and to help to solve some of these problems. And in case you're interested by our work and or the field, here is a couple of references. As Vito mentioned, we have an edition 2 of the handbook of biometrics, biometric anti-spoofing, that is there, but we have the third edition that is coming either probably in January. So thank you for your attention. And also in terms of software, you can find also software supporting the work I presented there. Thank you for your attention.